It's a pleasure and an honor for me to be in Japan. The first atomic bomb that was dropped here. Which is one of the most inhuman acts that has been done in this world according to me. Allah says that if anyone kills any other human being, unless it be for murder or for spreading corruption in the land, it is as though he has killed the whole of humanity. Islam is religion of peace. The Western country said, war for peace, war for peace. It is not war for peace, it is war on peace. What is Islam? Islam has the solution to the problems of humanity. Allah says, وَإِمْ مِنْ أُمَّةٍ إِلَّا خَلَا فِيهَا نَذِيرٌ. There is not a nation or a tribe to whom we have not sent a warner. Quran is the last and final revelation. It was not sent only for the Muslims or only for the Arabs. It was sent for the whole of humankind. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was the last and final messenger of Islam. He was not sent only for the Muslims or only for the Arabs, but as a mercy to all the worlds. The Quran is referred as the Furqan. That is the criteria to judge right from wrong, and it was revealed for the whole of humankind. All the human beings have been created from one pair. We have one common great grandparents, Adam and Eve. If we follow the Quran and the guidance of the authentic hadith, we can coexist and live peacefully throughout the world. This Quran is the future world constitution. If this religion of peace spreads, then discrimination will disappear, racism will disappear, dishonesty will disappear, alcoholism will disappear, drug addiction will disappear, prostitution will disappear, adultery will disappear, fornication will disappear. The best solution for the problems of humanity can be given by the creator of the human beings. Every human being should believe in the true God Allah and believe in the teachings of the Quran, which is for the whole of humanity, and the teachings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Inna deena indallahi al-Islam. The only religion acceptable in the sight of Allah is Islam. Udkhulu fi silmi kaffa. Enter into Islam wholeheartedly. You believe there's one God?
Yeah.
You believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
Yeah,強制 されてません.
Are you doing it out of your own free will?
Yeah, 大丈夫です。はい。
Ashhadu.
Ashhadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashhadu.
Wa ashhadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasul.
I bear witness.
That.
There is no God.
There is.
No God.
No God.
But Allah
and
Prophet Muhammad,
Prophet Muhammad
is
the messenger
and
servant
of Allah.
Masha
Allah, you become Muslim. Pork has been prohibited in the Quran in no less than 4 different places. Allah says in the Quran, forbidden for you for food, dead meat, blood, the flesh of swine, and any food on which any name besides Allah's name is taken. Pork is also prohibited in the Bible, in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8. Inshallah, you won't have pork. From today, you won't have pork.
I don't want to eat pork.
Mashallah, very good. Sister, do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No.
No. You're doing out of your own free will. Ashadu.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness. That.
That is.
No God.
But Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad. Is the messenger.
And servant.
Of Allah. Masha Allah, you've become a Muslim. Allahu Akbar. I request the Japanese to say Shahada. If I don't, on the day of judgment, God will ask me, why didn't you request this Japanese to say the Shahada? Ashadu. Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Allah.
Muhammad.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah.
Allah の他に神はない。そしてムハンマド様が Allah の使徒である、しもべであることを。
MashaAllah, very good. MashaAllah. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do the tears of joy.
Salam.
If Almighty God wanted, He could have made all the people in the earth as Muslims. Almighty God created a different creation, the human beings, which has the free will to obey or disobey God. Ashhadu. Allah. Ilaha.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Allah.
Muhammad.
Abduhu.
Warasuluhu.
I bear witness. That.
There is.
No God.
But.
Allah.
And.
Prophet Muhammad.
Is.
The messenger.
And.
Servant.
Servant of Allah.
Of Allah.
MashaAllah, you have become Muslim.
Salam.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes, one God.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Allah.
Muhammad.
Abduhu.
Warasuluhu.
Salam.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Believe. When a believer knows the truth, tears flow out of the eyes. MashaAllah, when the truth comes, the person is overfilled with joy. But would you like to say it in Arabic, sister?
Yes. Salam.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Allah.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu. I bear witness. That.
There is no God.
But Allah. And Prophet Muhammad. Is the messenger.
And servant.
Of Allah. Masha sister, you're a Muslim and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
Salam.
Now we'll say Shahada. Ashadu.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Allah.
Muhammad.
Abduhu.
Warasuluhu.
Takbir.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
You believe Jesus is God or do you believe he is a messenger?
A messenger.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes. Yes.
You believe?
Yes.
So would you like to become a Muslim?
Yes.
Ashadu?
Ashadu.
Allah?
Allah.
Ilaha?
Ilaha.
Illallah?
Ilaha.
Wa ashadu?
Ashadu.
Anna?
Anna.
Muhammadan?
Muhammadan.
Abduhu?
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu?
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness. That?
That
there is no God.
There is no God.
But Allah. And Prophet Muhammad. Is.
The messenger.
Of Allah.
Of Allah.
MashaAllah, we are Muslim, and I pray to Allah Subhanahu wa Taala. Do you believe there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe that worshipping idols is wrong?
It's wrong.
Sister, do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
MashaAllah. Would you like to say it in Arabic? Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No.
Are you doing out of your own free will? Free will. No one is forcing you?
No.
Is there anyone bribing you, giving you money?
No.
MashaAllah. Because in Islam, to force anyone is prohibited. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness.
That.
There is no God.
But Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad.
Is the messenger.
Of Allah.
MashaAllah,
become Muslim.
Salam.
I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through you, he may get the other Japanese and your family members to the correct fold of Islam.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Inshallah, I hope that you believe in one God.
Okay, yeah.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger?
Yeah.
So would you like to say it in Arabic?
Okay.
Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Allah.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Rahulu.
I bear witness.
That.
There is no God.
Except Allah.
And Prophet Muhammad. Is the messenger of Allah.
Salam.
I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he make me and Peace TV instrumental in fulfillment of the hadith that Islam will enter every home. The glorious Quran is the last and final revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of Almighty God, which was revealed to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
Actually, I would like to convert in Islam.
MashaAllah. Brother, for becoming a Muslim, you have to believe there is one God.
Yeah.
You have to believe idol worship is wrong.
Now I got it.
Thank you. And you also believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Brother, is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
Nobody.
Are you doing out of your own free will?
Yes.
Is anyone pressurizing you?
No, nobody.
Anyone giving you money?
Nobody. It's me.
Brother, I've said in Arabic and you can repeat it.
Okay.
Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Allah.
Wa ashadu.
Rashidu.
Anna.
Muhammadan. Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu. I bear witness.
That.
There is no God. But Allah. And I bear witness. That. Prophet Muhammad.
Is the messenger.
And servant of Allah.
I want you to prove to me about Jesus Christ, is he is a God or not?
How sure you are that the Quran is not Satanic origin?
Hi, I'm Susanna. I actually have a few questions, but I think I'll limit it to 2 questions.
On behalf of people here, first, let me thank you very much for being on stage for 4 hours.
I'm from KL.
Actually, I'm one of your fan.
Dr. Zakir Naik, honestly to say, I've been following you since I was 16 years old, when I was in secondary school. Alright? I am a Christian, and personally to say, you are one of my idols, beside my Chief Minister in Sarawak, Tan Sri Adnan Satim. My name is Tidius, Anak Ajang. I'm from Sarawak, from Borneo. If I have the chance, I would like to go in front and check hand and have a hug from you.
My name is Mahesh Kumar. I follow you. Can I take 1 minute to salam with you?
My name is Douglas. Sir, can I give you a hug?
I as a Dai, or I as a Muslim, I have to correct his picture of Islam. And I will tell him, Islam is not a merciless religion. It is the most merciful religion, derived from the word salam, which means peace.
I'm Michelle.
Michelle.
I'm from Buddhist.
Buddhist background?
Yes.
Sister, do you believe that there's one God?
Yes.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is a messenger of God?
Yeah.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No.
You're doing it out of your free will?
Yes.
Inshallah. I say it in Arabic and you can repeat it.
Okay.
Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Warasuluhu.
Warasuluhu.
I bear witness.
That.
There is no God.
There's no God.
But Allah.
But Allah.
And. I bear witness. That. Prophet Muhammad. Is the messenger. And servant of Allah.
Servant of Allah.
MashaAllah, you're a Muslim sister.
And thank you.
Pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says in Surah An-Nahl, chapter 16, verse 125, Udu ila sabili rabbika bilhikma wal ma'azat al hasna wajadun billati ahsan. Invite all to the way of thy Lord with the wisdom and beautiful preaching, and argue with them and reason with them in the ways that are best and most gracious. Allah says, go and argue, but with hikmah and with ma'azat al hasna.
My name is Joel. Okay, I'm Draven.
Do you believe there is one God?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
So that means you're a Muslim according to me. So would you like to say it in Arabic?
Yes.
So doing out of your own free will?
Yes.
I'll say in Arabic and you repeat it. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna. Muhammadan. Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu. I bear witness. That.
There
is no God but Allah.
There is no God but Allah.
And I bear witness. That Prophet Muhammad.
Prophet Muhammad.
Is the messenger of Allah. MashaAllah, I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may He grant you Jannah and may He help you to get other people to the throne. Ar-Rahman, Allama al-Quran. This Quran is from Ar-Rahman, the most merciful God. Do you believe there's one Allah?
Yes, I believe.
Do you believe Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah?
Yes.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam back?
I think it's my free will.
MashaAllah. I'll say it in Arabic and you can repeat it. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu. Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu. I bear witness.
That.
There is no God.
But Allah.
And I bear witness. That. Prophet Muhammad. Is. The messenger of Allah. And I pray to Allah that may He grant you Jannah. Salam, you have come back. Salam, and Allah has forgiven all your sin. Commonality between Veda, Bible and Quran is, Almighty God has got no pratima, has got no image, has got no picture, has got no portrait, has got no statue, has got no idol, has got no sculpture. Correct?
Absolute yes.
Yes. All these scriptures say the last and final messenger to come is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger?
Oh, absolutely yes.
Muslim by definition means a person who submits his will to God. Do you want to submit your will to God, brother? Do you want to follow the commandment of God?
Oh, yes.
So, brother, now you believe that there's one God, correct?
Correct.
You believe idol worship is wrong, correct?
Correct.
You believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
According to me, you have fulfilled the basic requirement of being a Muslim.
Thank you.
Brother, would you like to proclaim it in Arabic?
I have been waiting this for 24 years.
Oh, good.
I think this is the opportunity for me, and I will say yes.
Is anyone forcing you to become a Muslim?
No.
Is anyone pressurizing you?
No.
Is anyone bribing you?
No.
Brother, I will say it in Arabic, and you can repeat it. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness
that
there is no God.
There is no God
but Allah.
But Allah.
And I bear witness.
And I bear witness
that Prophet Muhammad.
Prophet Muhammad
is the messenger.
Is the messenger
and servant of Allah.
And servant of Allah.
Masha Allah. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa taala.
My name is Eurasia. I'm a non-Muslim and I would like to take my shahada.
Takbir! Takbir! Takbir!
Sister, may I know what is the background?
I'm a Roman Catholic.
Sister, do you believe that there is one God?
Yes.
Do you believe Jesus is messenger of God?
Yes.
Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger?
Yes, I do.
Is anyone forcing you to accept Islam?
No.
Are you doing out of your own free will?
Yes, I love Allah.
Is anyone pressurizing you?
No.
Anyone giving you money?
No.
I'll just say it in Arabic and you repeat it. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Wa ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Rasuluhu.
Rasuluhu.
I bear witness
that
there is no God
but Allah
and I bear witness
that
Prophet Muhammad
is the messenger
and a servant of Allah. MashaAllah, I've become a Muslim, sister, and I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he grant you Jannah. Do you believe there's one God?
Yes.
Do you believe Jesus is God?
No.
MashaAllah. Do you believe that Prophet Muhammad is the messenger of God?
Yes.
Sister, if you believe that there is one God, if you believe Jesus is not God, and you believe Jesus is the messenger of God, and you believe Prophet Muhammad is the messenger, then according to me, you are a Muslim. Would you like to recite the Shahada? Shahada means, say there is one God, and Prophet Muhammad is the messenger.
Inshallah.
MashaAllah. I say it in Arabic and you repeat inshallah. Ashadu.
Ashadu.
Allah.
Allah.
Ilaha.
Ilaha.
Illallah.
Illallah.
Wa ashadu.
Ashadu.
Anna.
Anna.
Muhammadan.
Muhammadan.
Abduhu.
Abduhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
Wa rasuluhu.
I bear witness.
Salam, salam, salam.
I bear witness.
That. There is no God.
But Allah. And
I bear witness
that
Prophet Muhammad
is the messenger
and servant
of Allah.
MashaAllah, you have become Muslim. And I believe you were a Muslim. I pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that may he grant you Jannah. I congratulate the atheist because he has said the first part of the Islamic Shahada, Islamic creed, La ilaha, there is no God. The only thing I have to do is illallah but Allah, which I shall do inshallah.
We have question from mic 1.
Okay.
It's good to see you here, Dr. Zakir. My name is Derek, and my profession is actually a tunnel engineer. I'm sorry, Dr. Zakir, my question will be slightly not relevant to terrorism, but I just want to ask a very brief question. According to Surah 43 Al-Zukhruf, it says here, Surah 43:61, it says, Jesus shall be the sign for the coming of the hour. Does that mean Jesus will come as the final prophet? Or is Muhammad, or Prophet Muhammad, the final prophet? So if Prophet Muhammad is going to come as the last prophet, so who exactly is Isa al-Masih, or Jesus Christ? Thank you.
Brother, a very good question. And he quote a verse of the Quran saying that Isa alayhi salam, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will be the sign of the hour. So does it mean Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, is the last prophet, or Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is the last prophet? What is it? Quran clearly mentions in Surah Ahzab, chapter number 33, verse number 40, مَا قَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَهَدٍ مِّ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَاكِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ وَخَاتِمِ النَّبِينَ وَقَانَ اللَّهُ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمًا. That means Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Muhammad is not the father of any of you men. مَا قَانَ مُحَمَّدٌ أَبَا أَهَدٍ مِّ رِجَالِكُمْ وَلَاكِ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ. But he is the messenger of Allah, and he is the seal of the Prophet. Allah is all-knowing, full of knowledge. So Quran is very explicit and clear in Surah Azab, chapter 33, verse number 40, that Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger. After him, no messenger comes. But you rightly said the Quran also says that Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, is the sign for the hour. Quran says that, and even Bible says that. Bible says in the Gospel of John that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, will come in the second coming. Even Quran says he'll come again. Why? Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is the only messenger amongst all the messengers of Almighty God whose followers mistook that he claimed divinity. You're a Christian, brother?
Yes, I am.
Do you consider Jesus to be God?
Yes, he has the divinity.
That's what I told you. Jesus Christ is the only messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whose followers mistook him to be God. I will come to your Jesus as God later on, peace be upon him. First, I'll give the reply to your question. Because the followers of the messenger, Jesus, peace be upon him, mistook him to be God, that's the reason Allah says in the Quran in Surah Nisa, chapter 4, 158, Allah raised him up alive. Allah raised him up alive because he was the only messenger whose followers mistook him to be God. In his second coming, he will not bring any new rule. He will come as Ummati of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because Allah says in the Quran in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 3, on this day have I completed my favor on you and have chosen for you Islam. Once the religion is complete, nothing new can be added or taken out. But Isa alayhi salam, in his second coming, will come to testify he never claimed divinity. Quran says in Surah Maidah, chapter 5, verse number 116, that, O Allah, you be my witness. I never told them to worship me, but I worship Allah, Ubudullah, who is my Lord and your Lord. So in his second coming, he will come to clarify he never claimed divinity. And even in the Bible today, if you read the Bible, Islam is the only non-Christian faith which makes it an article of faith to believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. No Muslim is a Muslim if he does not believe in Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. We believe that he was one of the mightiest messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We believe that he was the Messiah, translated Christ. We believe that he was born miraculously without any male intervention, which many modern day Christians do not believe. We believe that he gave life to the dead with God's permission. We believe he healed those born blind and lepers with God's permission. The Christians and the Muslims are going together. But one may ask, where is the parting of ways? The parting of ways is that majority of the Christians, they believe that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, claimed divinity. They believe that he was God. In fact, if you read the Bible, there is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me. If you can point out from any version of the Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says any unambiguous statement, any unequivocal statement in the Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I, Dr. Zakir Naik, am ready to accept Christianity today. I am not speaking on behalf of my other Muslim brothers and sisters. I am a student of comparative religion. In fact, if you read the Bible, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, himself said, it's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse number 28, Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, my Father is greater than I. Gospel of John, chapter number 10, verse number 29, my Father is greater than all. Gospel of Matthew, chapter number 12, verse number 28, I cast out devil with the Spirit of God. Gospel of Luke, chapter number 11, verse number 20, I with the finger of God cast out devil. Gospel of John, chapter number 5, verse number 30, I can of my own self do nothing. As I hear, I judge, and my judgment is just. For I seek not my will, but the will of my Father. Anyone who says I seek not my will, but the will of Almighty God is a Muslim. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is a Muslim. He never claimed divinity. It's mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 14, verse 24. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said that the words that you hear are not mine, but my Father's who has sent me. Mentioned in the Gospel of John, chapter number 17, verse number 3. This is life eternal, so that you may know there is one God and Jesus Christ whom thou hast sent. It's mentioned in the book of Acts, chapter number 2, verse number 22. Ye men of Israel, listen to this. Jesus of Nazareth, a man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, and you are witness to it. A man approved of God amongst you by wonders and miracles and signs which God did by him, you are witness to it. So if you read the Bible, we understand that same thing what the Quran says. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, the messenger of God. He was not God. He never claimed divinity. So if you read the Bible, this is the teaching of the church. To understand Christianity, don't look at the Christians, read the Bible. To understand Islam, don't look at the Muslims, read the Quran and the authentic Hadith. That's the reason Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, Almighty God raised him up alive. So that he will tell people like you and people who claim he was God. He will come in his second coming to clarify his name. He will be the Ummati of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. He will believe in the same teachings of Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he will testify, he never claimed divinity but said, Ubudullah, worship Allah, my Lord and your Lord. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we take the next question from the sisters?
Assalamu alaikum everyone here. My name is Revati. Brother Zakir, I'm your great fan. I'm very much enlightened by your talks and lectures on Islam and comparative religion. I have been reading Quran and I have a lot of Muslim friends. I'm from Singapore, born and brought up in India. I have some questions and please clarify. Thank you so much. My question is, can we relate the regeneration of skin for hellfire as stated in Quran chapter 4 verse 56 as reincarnation of new life for real suffering? Thank you.
Sister asked a very good question.
Thank you.
She said that can we relate? She said that she has heard my talks and she is impressed, alhamdulillah. That is the reason she is quoting with reference, alhamdulillah. She is saying that the Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 56 that the skin is replaced so that you can feel the pain. Is it similar to reincarnation and a person is born again in this world? Sister, both are different. What Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 56, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them in the hellfire. And as often as their skins are roasted, we shall give them fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Previously, science thought that only brain was responsible for feeling of pain. Today we come to know that in the skin there are pain receptors which are responsible for feeling of pain, which we did not know earlier. Quran says that God will give fresh skin so that they shall feel the pain. Scientifically it is proven. Now for example, Almighty God is just. Quran says in Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 40, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is never unjust in the least degree. That means he is very just. For example, history tells us that Hitler incinerated 6 million Jews. Today, if our law catches Hitler, what punishment can you give? Maximum you can give is kill him. That will take care of one. What about the remaining 5,999,000 people that he has killed? In the Akhirah, in next life, Almighty God says, as to those who reject our signs, we shall cast them in the hellfire. As often as the skins are roasted, we'll give them a fresh skin. If Almighty God wants to incinerate Hitler 6 million times, he can do it. 12 million times he can do it. This is an example of the punishment in the next life. This does not justify about the cycle of rebirth. This cycle of rebirth, sister, if you read in the Vedas, Veda is the most authentic book amongst all the Hindu scriptures. The Veda speaks about Punarjanam in Rig Veda, volume number 10, Punarjanam. Punar means next, Janam means birth. Even we believe in next birth. Even Quran talks about next life. Once we die, we'll be resurrected on the day of judgment. Same thing Veda says. Punarjanam means next life. But the scholars of Hinduism, they came out with a philosophy known as samskara. Samskara in Hinduism, it is the cycle of birth, rebirth, birth, rebirth, birth, rebirth. This is nowhere mentioned in the Veda. Veda speaks only about next life, which even Quran speaks. But the scholars of Hinduism could not justify how people are born. Some people are born handicapped. Some people are born in poor family. Some people are born with congenital heart disease. So God cannot be unjust. So to justify the justice of God, they come with a new philosophy called as samskara, cycle of birth, death, birth, death. Maybe in their previous life, they did some wrong deed, therefore they are born handicapped. This is the philosophy of the Hindu scholars, not of the scripture. Your Vedas are very explicit, punarjanam, next life. Even Quran says you come in this world. Allah says in the Quran in Surah Mulk, chapter number 16, verse number 2, Alladhi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It is Allah who has created death and life to test which of you is good indeed. So this world you have only life once. Once you die, Almighty God will resurrect you on the day of judgment. That's what the Vedas say. But the Hindu scholars, they could not explain why some children are born deaf, some dumb, some with heart disease, some in a poor family. Because they could not justify, they came with this philosophy which is not mentioned in the Vedas. Same way if you read Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita says that how does a soul change body? How does a caterpillar, when he goes to a blade, he jumps onto a new blade? Same way the soul changes into a new body. Doing once we have no problem, but doing multiple times is totally wrong. Now, I will give the explanation, what does Islam has to say that? Now you will ask me the question, okay, if the Hindu Pandits are wrong, what is the explanation in Quran? In Islam, as I mentioned, Allah says in Surah Mulk, chapter 16, verse number 2, Alladhi khalaqal mauta wal hayata. It's Almighty God has created death and life to test which of his good indeed. So this life, sister, is the test for the hereafter. Every year when you appear for the examination, the test paper keeps on changing, right or wrong? You can't have the same paper. Similarly, Almighty God tests different people in different ways. The Quran says, your children are a test for you. Quran says, your wealth is a test for you. So Almighty God makes some human beings born poor, some rich. For the rich people, they have to give zakat. In Islam, every rich person who has a saving of more than 85 grams of gold, he or she should give 2.5% of that saving every lunar year in charity called as zakat. Poor man, there is no zakat. He gets 100 out of 100 marks in zakat. The rich man, if he doesn't give zakat, he'll get zero. If he gives half zakat, he'll get 50%. We say, are gareeb hai, are poor man. That poor man is good, in akhirah is passing. So poverty is a test, wealth is a test. Whether do you follow the commandment of Almighty God? The Quran says even your children are a test. Maybe there's a couple who's very pious. To that couple is born a baby who has congenital heart disease. That baby has done no sin. Quran says every child is born as a masoom. Every child is born sinless. It is a test for the parents. That do the parents yet have faith in Almighty God? If the parent has less faith, he will start complaining, what type of God is this? I have prayed so much, yet he is giving me a child with handicap. A good Muslim, he will say, Alhamdulillah, praise be to Allah. He will accept it. He will not complain. Maybe God wants to give that parent higher degree. If you pass your bachelor's in arts, easy test, you get bachelor's degree. But if you pass MBBS, you get doctor in front of your name. But to pass MBBS is difficult. So maybe Almighty God wants to give that parents a higher degree in Jannah. Even if they pray five times, now God wants to test them by giving them a child which is handicapped. To see whether the parents yet have faith in God or not. If they pass the test, they get a higher degree in Jannah. So the wealth, poverty, health, disease is a test. It is nothing to do with your previous life. That is the theory of the Pandits, not of Vedas. So Veda is the same thing what Quran is talking about. You come in this world once, then you have next life, Punarjanam. But not death, birth, this is not part of Veda. Hope that answers the question, sister. Sister, do you believe there is one God?
I believe that there is one God and Prophet is the final messenger, thank you.
MashaAllah, do you believe idol worship is wrong?
No, I am not doing idol worship for the past 9 years. And I would like to take Shahada with my children in Singapore later. Thank you so much.
Can we move to the brothers section? Do we have a question from a non-Muslim?
Hi, I have a question, very simple and short. How Islam define love? And what is love?
You have asked the question that how does Islam define love and what is love? Love, brother, is the care and the craving for one for another. It can be between human beings, it can be between different creatures, it can be between you and your creator. And it's clearly mentioned, it says that Allah is the one who loves in the Quran in two places. So love is a craving and the affection between two creatures, between two human beings, can be between you and your creator. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Rum, chapter number 30, verse number 21, that amongst his signs he has created for you mate amongst yourself so that you may dwell with them in tranquility. Allah says that he has created for you mates, spouses, wife and husband, so that you may dwell with each other in tranquility. So Almighty God has put love between the hearts. Almighty God says he has put love between the hearts of the husband and wife, so that you may dwell with each other in tranquility. That means you care for each other. If she gets hurt, you are hurt. If she is happy, you are happy. So all this is love. And therefore God says that he has put this love between the man and the woman, between the husband and wife. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the brother's side?
Good night. My name is Lim Kim Piu. So I think it is good for the Muslim extremists against the Western Christian who are ego and proud, because the Western Christian are rich, developed and progressed, and they look down on the Hindu, Muslim and Buddhist. And the Muslim consists of over 40 countries, and the Buddhist over 10 countries, and the Hindu just a few. Nobody dare to challenge against the Christian. Only the Muslim dare to challenge against the Christian.
The brother has said emotionally that the Christian of the Western country, they look down upon the Buddhists, the Muslims, the Hindus, and no one dares to challenge the Western Christians except the Muslims. Brother, I slightly differ. What you are saying is right. All Muslims don't have the guts to challenge the Western world. There are some Muslims like Tun Dr. Mahathir Muhammad. All the Muslims don't have the guts. And I am a person who is not very much in favor of politicians. There are very few politicians who I respect, and one of them is Tun Dr. Mahathir Muhammad. And I remember when I met him the first time several years back in Abu Dhabi, we were discussing, and he said that if the Muslims, if the Arabs stop dealing in dollars, America will come on its knees immediately. There are few politicians who I really care, One was King Faisal of Saudi Arabia. He had the guts. I remember when you read his biography that when oil was discovered, he said, let's have the meeting in the desert. And that time when they pressurized the Muslims, King Faisal said that we are Badus, we are Bedouin, we are Arabs, we can go back to the desert. What will happen to you when we stop giving you oil? And I believe one of the things of Dr. Tun Mahathir Mohamad was that if he had the control of the oil, what the Arabs had, he would have ruled the world. That's why I said in my lecture of terrorism Muslim monopoly that most of the terrorist acts, directly or indirectly, are related to politicians. They try and create the vote bank, they create all this problem. In Islam, we do not believe that we should look down upon one another based on caste, color or creed. Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Hujurat, chapter number 49, verse number 13, Ya ayyuha an-nasu inna khalaqnakum min zakarin wa unsa wa jalnakum shu'uban wa qabaila lita'arafu innakum min Allahi yatqakum inna Allaha 'alimun khabir. O humankind, we have created you from a single pair of male and female and have divided you into nations and tribes so that you will recognize each other, not that you shall despise each other. And the most honored in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the person who has taqwa. The criteria for judgment in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the only way one human being can be superior to the other human being is not by wealth, it's not by color, it's not by creed, it's not by sex, but it is taqwa, it is God consciousness, it is piety, it is righteousness. In Islam, we do not believe one human being is superior because of wealth or color or caste or creed. It is taqwa. And I do agree with you. I do agree with you totally that the Western world, they think that they are superior. They think they are superior. The only way you can be superior is by being extra God conscious, by being righteous, by being pious, not by setting rules. And when the Western world talks about justice, when they talk about freedom of expression, if it does not hurt them, you have freedom of expression. If it hurts them, no freedom of expression. And the Western world talking about justice, I feel that one of the most unjust countries in the world are the Western countries. They talk about justice, but they are far away from justice. However much they are trying to attack Islam, Islam is growing. Islam is growing. There are, mashallah, few Muslims who speak against the Western world, and the Western world tries and shut their voice. That's what they tried to do to your ex-prime minister, but mashallah, Allah helped him and he came up again. We know the history. And that's what they do, that those Muslims who speak the truth, because of my being very vocal and speaking the truth, the Western world doesn't like me speaking the truth. I'd like to give an example. I have been to UK several times. In 2010, when we had had the Wembley Arena, we had had the NEC Arena in Birmingham, there the Home Secretary took objection to one of my statements. I said that killing innocent people is prohibited in Islam. And I said that thousands of people killed in the Twin Tower is to be condemned. The thousands of human beings killed in Twin Tower blast in 9/11 is to be condemned. More than 50 people killed in the London Tube blast is to be condemned. More than 180 people killed in Bombay in the train blast has to be condemned. But I told the Muslim, don't put a full stop. Besides condemning all this, I also condemn the thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan, in Iraq and Palestine. So the Home Secretary of UK put a ban. Zakir cannot enter UK. I told that the thousands of Americans killed in the Twin Tower, I condemn. More than 50 Britishers killed in London, condemn. More than 180 Indians killed, condemn. But I was careful, the thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan. I didn't say thousands of Afghanistanis. Because, you know, the Western world considers some are terrorists. So I was careful in using my statement. Thousands of innocent people killed in Afghanistan, in Iraq, in Palestine. So they want to ban me. They talk about freedom of expression. As long as you don't expose them, they don't mind. Once you expose them, they don't like freedom of expression. So I do agree with you. But Alhamdulillah, Summa Alhamdulillah. However much they try and suppress Islam, Islam is spreading. The more they try and suppress Islam, the more Islam is spreading. Whatever they do, because Allah has given a promise that this deen will prevail over all the deens. And today, what the Western world is fearing maximum, they fear Islam. That's the reason they're bringing all these restrictions, etc. But what they do, inshallah, we believe in the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Islam will spread and is bound to spread. Allah doesn't require me or other people to make Islam spread. Allah has given a promise in the Quran, and inshallah, inshallah, very shortly, you will see this coming true, that the power from the Western world will be taken away. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the sister?
Very good evening, Dr. Zakir. My name is Shah. I'm a psychology student. I attended your previous lecture in UITM Shah Alam. I must say I enjoyed your lecture a lot. Even today I enjoyed your lecture. My question, however, is regarding the previous lecture. You spoke about universal brotherhood in UITM Shah Alam. At one point during the Q&A session, you mentioned that you were more Christian than the Christians. Now, I am not, from what I know, a person is a Christian provided they are either baptized into Christianity or they accept Jesus Christ as their personal savior. Only then a person is a Christian. So I just wanted to know how exactly you could refer to yourself as more Christian than the Christians. That's all.
Sister has asked a very good question. She asked a very good question. She heard my talk in Shah Alam and even here. She asked a question. I said that I'm more Christian than the Christians. How can I be a Christian if I'm not baptized, if I don't believe Jesus is God? Sister, you quoted me correct, but you didn't give my complete quotation. Before I said I'm more Christian than the Christian, I said one statement. If Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves. There was a criteria before saying that. If Christian means a person who believes in teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, then I'm more Christian than the Christian themselves. And then I said that the Bible says that Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, was circumcised on the eighth day. Most of the Christians aren't circumcised. All the Muslims are circumcised. Bible says in the book of Ephesians, chapter 5, verse number 18, don't have alcohol. In the book of Proverbs, chapter number 20, verse number 1, don't have alcohol. As a whole, the Muslims don't have alcohol, but the Christians have. Bible says in the book of Leviticus, chapter number 11, verse number 7 and 8, don't have pork. In the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 14, verse number 8, don't have pork. In the book of Isaiah, chapter 65, verse number 2 to 5, don't have pork. The Muslims don't have pork, but the Christians have. Bible says do hijab, that you cover your head. Bible says in the book of Deuteronomy, chapter number 22, verse number 5, in 1 Timothy, chapter number 2, verse number 9, in the 1 Corinthians, chapter number 11, verse number 5 and 6, do hijab. The Muslim as a whole do hijab, but the Christian don't cover the head. So if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, we Muslims are more Christian than the Christian themselves.
But that's my point. Christianity doesn't mean a person who follows the teachings of Christ,
because
of Nazareth was a Jew. He was born a Jew, he lived a Jewish life, and he died a Jew. So if you were to follow the teachings of Jesus of Nazareth, it wouldn't make you a Christian, it would make you a Jew, because he taught you Jewish teachings. However, accepting Jesus of Nazareth as your personal savior, and only through him you can go to heaven,
That, however, Dr. Okay, Zakir, sister, will make you a Christian.
Point out one verse of the Bible which says that accepting Jesus Christ as your Savior will make you go to heaven. Give me one equivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me, I will accept your type of Christianity today. What you are talking is the teaching of the church, not of the Bible.
Yes, I'm exactly, because from the church you get...
Wait. Sister,
yes.
You want to understand the religion? Read the scripture, don't look at the followers. Okay. Don't look at the followers. I told you, if you want to understand Islam, don't look at the Muslim. Read the scripture, the Quran, and the authentic saying of Prophet Muhammad. If I want to understand Christianity, I'll not look at the church. Who is the church? Church is not the custodian
the
of the Bible.
The church is who created Christians. If not for the church,
that's
there
what,
won't be any
That's what I'm telling you.
Christians,
don't follow the church. Follow Jesus Christ, peace be upon him.
If there wasn't a church, you won't know Jesus Christ. So in order to know Christ, you must give recognition to the church.
Sister, to know Christianity, you have to read the Bible, not the church. See, do you know how many types of church are there? Sister, which church do you belong to? Today, there are more than 2,000 different denominations of church. 2,000 different Christians you'll have. Do you know that? Baptist, Seventh-day Adventist, Jehovah's Witness. Which church do you belong to? 2,000 different types of church. Do you know that?
Yes, I know. I'm
so do you mean to think that 2,000 different types of Christians here? That's the reason, sister. If you want to understand Christianity, read the Bible. If you want to know the teachings of Jesus Christ, don't go to the church. Go to the Bible. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me. So when Jesus Christ did not say, if you believe Jesus Christ to be the highest authority, which I consider him to be a messenger is far superior than the church. There is not a single unequivocal statement in the complete Bible where Jesus Christ, peace be upon himself, says that I am God, or where he says worship me. Because of this attitude of yours, there are 2,000 different churches and there are 2,000 different types of Christianity. Which Christianity will you follow? If you want to follow Islam, read the Quran and the authentic hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you want to follow Hinduism, read the Vedas and the Upanishad. If you want to be a Christian, read the Bible. If you read all these scriptures, you will come closer to one true God. That God which has got no image. That God is only one God, doesn't have any children, doesn't have any parents. And Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that here shall he say, he shall glorify me. Here Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, is talking about the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, to come. Peace be upon him. So he's telling all of you that follow the last and final messenger. But you don't want to follow. Because if everyone follows the last and final messenger, who will follow the church? Jesus Christ never said follow the church. Which verse of the Bible says that? Which verse of the Bible? So what you have to realize, read the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Anyone who tries and takes you away from Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, he's not good. That's the reason I said that if Christian means a person who follows the teachings of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, I'm more Christian than the Christian themselves. Jesus Christ was circumcised, I'm circumcised. What has the church got to do in between that now? Jesus Christ has said you follow all the commandments in the Old Testament. Old Testament said don't have pork, yet the church says have pork. Who will you follow? Who is superior, Jesus Christ or the church? That's the reason to understand any religion. Read the scripture, you'll come closer to that religion.
Thank you. Okay, we will move to the brothers at the back.
My name is Munishri Vatsa. I strictly believe in God, and I believe that religion is a way of worshipping the God. So does this religion really matters to acquire the enlightenment?
Brother says he believes in God and he believes religion is a type of worshipping God. Does it help in enlightenment? Yes, brother. You rightly said that you believe in God. Religion is worshipping God. Religion, according to the Oxford Dictionary, means a belief in a supernatural controlling power, a God or gods that deserve worship. So religion means to understand God, and religion is mainly a way of life. So you ask me, does it matter? How do you worship God? Yes, it matters a lot. Because if you worship the wrong God, that means you are not thanking your Creator. And that God is same for all human beings. Whether Christian, Hindu, Muslim, whether you live in America or Malaysia or India, our God, our Creator, our Sustainer is one. You have to worship Him alone and no one else. If you worship a false God, then you will not be thanking the Creator. Therefore, it's very important to identify who is the Creator, who is our Sustainer, and worship Him alone and no one else. If you worship a false God, then you won't be thanking your Creator and you will not be fulfilling your duty as a good human being. Hope that answers the question, brother.
Thank you.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the brother, please?
My CK Chong, I don't know the English, my friend transfers. I有第一件事讲, 如果你们是你们的Muslim的Bible先的话, 还是我们基督教的Bible先? 如果有你们的先的话, 我们就跟你们一起信Muslim。 如果有我们的话, 问题就在哪里? 谁最久的是谁? 还是你们Muslim还是我们?
His question is, if Bible come first or Quran come first? If Quran come first, then why there is a teaching of Christian? Why people don't follow Quran? If Quran come first, then why people don't follow the teaching of Quran?
Brother asked a question that which came first, the Bible or the Quran? If Quran come first, then why aren't people following the teachings of Quran? Or if Bible come first, they should follow Bible. Brother, what comes first is not important. What is correct is important. For example, if there's a book written, you know, there are many books which we learn in medical college, in commerce, in engineering, edition 1, edition 2, revised edition, 9th edition, 10th edition, which will you follow, the first edition or the 10th edition? You will follow the latest. Anyway, latest is not always the correct. In Islam, I started my talk by quoting a verse of the Quran of Surah Isra, chapter 17, verse number 81. وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقْ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلِ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ قَانَ زَوْكَ. Tell that truth has arrived and falsehood perish, for falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. So it is not what comes first should be followed, what is correct should be followed. Most of the time, what comes latest is the best, but not always correct. There may be certain things which are previous, which came earlier, which may be correct. If you realize Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has sent several messengers on the face of the earth. By name 25 are mentioned. Adam, Noah, Abraham, Moses, Jesus, Muhammad, peace be upon them all. But all the messengers that came before were meant for a particular group of people and their message was supposed to be followed for a particular time period. Since Prophet Muhammad is the last and final messenger, he was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs, he was sent for the whole of humanity. Allah also says in the Quran in Surah Ra'd chapter 13 verse 38 that we have sent a revelation in every age. In every age have we sent a revelation. But by name only four are mentioned in the Quran. Torah, Zabur, Injil and the Quran. Torah is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to Moses, peace be upon him. Zabur is the Wahi, the revelation which was given to David, peace be upon him. Injil is the Wahi, the revelation given to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. And Quran is the last and final revelation given to the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now, all the revelation that came before the Quran were meant to be followed by a particular group of people and for a particular time period. Injil was revealed only for the Bani Israel and was meant to be followed until the last revelation came, the Quran. But what the Bible you have today is not completely the Word of God. All the revelation that came before the Quran, because they were time bound, Almighty God did not think it fit to preserve it. Today, the Bible that we have, according to the scholars of the Bible, they say that this is a mixture. It contains the Word of God, it contains the Word of prophets, it even contains history. I'm sorry to say, it even contains pornography. It's a mixture. The complete Bible, it contains contradiction. There are many scientific errors in the Bible. So you can't attribute all this to God. But whatever matches with the Quran, we Muslims have got no objection in accepting that portion of the Bible to be the Word of God. Today, if we analyze, that is the reason Allah says in the Quran, since Quran was the last and final revelation, all the previous revelation were only sent for those people. Like Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, the Quran says in Surah Al-Imran chapter 3 verse 49, he was sent only for Bani Israel. If you read the Bible says in the Gospel of Matthew chapter number 10, verse number 5 and 6, he tells the apostles, go ye not into the way of the Gentiles. Who are the Gentiles? The non-Jews. Enter ye not into the city of the Samaritans, but rather go to the house of the lost sheep of Israel. So Jesus Christ tells his apostles, only go to the Jews, don't go to non-Jews, don't go to Hindus, don't go to Muslim. Jesus Christ himself says in the Gospel of Matthew chapter number 15, verse number 24, I have not been sent but to the house of the lost sheep of Israel. So Jesus Christ was only sent for the Jews. Musa alayhi salam, Moses peace be upon, only sent for the Jews. But since Prophet Muhammad was the last and final messenger, he was not sent only for the Muslims or the Arabs. Allah says in Surah Anbiya chapter number 21, verse number 107, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we have sent thee not but as a mercy to all the worlds, to all the creatures, to all the human beings. And the Quran, because it was the last and final revelation, all the other previous revelation was sent only for a particular group of people and for a particular time period. Quran, because it was the last and final revelation, it was not sent only for the Muslims or only for the Malay or only for the Arab. It was sent for the whole humanity. Quran says in Surah Ibrahim chapter 14 verse number 1, Surah Ibrahim chapter 14 verse number 52, in Surah Baqarah chapter 2 verse number 185, and Surah Az-Zumur chapter 39 verse 41, that the Quran was sent for the whole of humankind. And because it was the last and final revelation, Allah says in Surah Hijr, chapter number 15, verse number 9, that we have revealed the Quran and we shall guard it from corruption. So Quran is the only religious scripture on the face of the earth which is pure. All the other scriptures, by the passage of time, they have got corrupted. And I proved this in my talk day for yesterday in Kuantan. Quran and modern science. If you apply the test of science, all the scriptures will fail except the Quran. Therefore, Quran is the only book which is authentic. And whatever Quran says, even the other scriptures, even after they have changed, the Bible, the other scriptures, yet there is remnants of the basic true message that God is one, he has got no image, he has got no idol. And the last and final messenger in all the scripture, whether it be the Bible, whether the Buddhist scripture, Dhammapad, whether Hindu scripture, Vedas, it says that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So even what my thing is to all the human beings, I say at least agree that one book is 100% the word of God. So Christian would say, I wouldn't mind believing Bible to be the word of God. The Hindu would say, I wouldn't mind believing Veda to be the word of God. The Muslim will say, I wouldn't mind believing Quran to be the word of God. Then I tell, let us agree to follow what is common in all these scriptures. And when we do a comparative study, we come to know that all the religious scriptures say that there's one God. He has got no image, he has got no idol, he has got no parents, he has got no children. All the scriptures say, the Bible, the Vedas, the Dhammapad, the Parsi scriptures, that the last and final messenger is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. So if we do a comparative study and follow the commonalities, we come to know that we have to believe in one God and the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from a non-Muslim sister from this mic?
Assalamu alaikum, Dr. Nai. My non-Muslim friend, I'm asking this question on behalf of her. She attended your Universal Brotherhood Conference and she really respects you. She believes in one God, but she is born in a Hindu family. So she thinks that whom she calls Brahma is what we call Khalik. So as long as he is following her religion, she should get salvation. Then how can we convince her that the only accepted religion to God is Islam? Thank you.
Sister posed a question. One of her Hindu friends had come for my talk in Shah Alam, Universal Brotherhood. And she liked the lecture, but she said that who she considers Brahma as God is same as Khalik, so can she go to Jannah? If you read the Hindu scriptures, if you read Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 1, verse number 3, one of the attributes given to God is Brahma. Brahma is called as the creator God. We Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator. If you translate creator into Arabic, it becomes Khalik. So we Muslims have got no objection if someone says Almighty God is creator or Khalik or Brahma. But if someone says Brahma is Almighty God who has got four heads and on each head is a crown, we Muslims take strong objection to it because you're going against Shvetashvatara Upanishad, chapter number 4, verse number 19, which says, Na achasya pratima asti, of that God there is no pratima. Pratima in Sanskrit means an image, a photograph, a painting, a picture, a portrait, a sculpture, a statue, an idol. So the Hindu scriptures as well as the Vedas, Yajurveda chapter 32 verse number 3 says, Na achasya pratima asti, of that God there is no image, there is no photograph, there is no painting, there is no picture, there is no sculpture, there is no idol. So the moment you give an image to God, that means it is not the true God. And in the Hindu scriptures, I had given a talk in Johor Bahru, Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the world religious scriptures. In the Hindu scriptures, it prophesizes the coming of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 5 to 8, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 3, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 10 to 27, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read Bhavishya Purana, Parva 3, Khanda 1, Adhyay 3, Shlokas 21 to 23, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you read the Kuntab Suktas, Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 127, verse number 1 to 14, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I can give references from Hindu scriptures. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 6. Atharva Ved, book number 20, hymn number 21, verse number 7, it talks about Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is called as the one who praises Ahmad in several places. In Yajurveda chapter 31, verse number 18. In Rig Veda, book number 8, hymn number 6, verse number 10. In Atharva Veda, book number 8, hymn number 5, verse number 16. In Atharva Veda, book number 20, hymn number 126, verse number 14. He is called as Nara Shansa. Nar means man, Shansa means praises, one who praises. If you translate Nara Shansa into Arabic, it becomes Muhammad. He is named as Muhammad Narashansa in several places in Hindu scriptures. In Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 13, verse number 3. In Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 18, verse number 9. In Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 106, verse number 4. Rig Veda, book number 1, hymn number 142, verse number 3. Rig Veda, book number 2, hymn number 3, verse number 2. Rig Veda, book number 5, hymn number 5, verse number 2. Rig Veda, book number 7, hymn number 2, verse number 2. Rig Veda, book number 10, hymn number 100, verse number 3. Yajurveda, chapter number 20, verse number 37. Yajurveda, chapter number 20, verse 57. Yajurveda, chapter number 21, verse number 31. Yajurveda, chapter number 28, verse number 2. Yajurveda, chapter number 28, verse number 19. Yajurveda, chapter number 28, verse number 42. I can go on and giving references only of Hindu scriptures about the last and final messenger, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. He is even prophesied as Kalki Avatar. If you read Kalki Purana, chapter number 2, verse number 5, 7, 11, 15, it says that the last and final messenger, his father's name shall be Vishnu Yas, that is servant of God, Abdullah, which was the name of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's father. His mother's name will be Sumati, which means peace, serenity, in Arabic Amina, which was the name of the mother of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He'll be born in the village of Sambala, that is the village of peace and serenity, Makkah. He'll be born in the family of the chief of village of Sambala. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born in the family of Quraysh. It says he'll be born on 12th day of Madhav, 12th Rabbi Awal. He will have four friends, the first for Khulafa Rashidin. There are so many prophecies. So if she's a good Hindu, she should believe in one God who has got no idol and no image. You should believe in the last and final messenger, the Kalki Avatar Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from non-Muslim brothers at the back?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Good evening, Dr. Zakir Naik. My name is Kamal Nadan. I'm a student. And my question is, a few years back, Malaysian Fatwa Council, they banned Muslims from doing yoga. They say it's against Islam. Is that true? Is it true from the point of Al-Quran? Thank you.
Brother asked the question that some council in Malaysia banned Muslims from doing yoga because it's against Islam. Brother asking that, is it against the Quran? Brother, yoga is a form of exercise. which is derived from various places, including the Vedas. And in yoga, you may say things, for example, I'm aware of something, I'm not an expert in yoga, but I'm aware that in yoga, you may have to say certain things like Om, and narrate and chant certain things. All these things may lead to shirk. It may lead to shirk. That means you're calling somebody else as the creator besides Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Islam, as I mentioned in my talk, according to Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 48 and Surah Nisa chapter 4 verse 116, Allah will forgive any sin, but the sin of shirk He'll never forgive. Shirk is associating partners with God. So if you associate anyone else with God, call anyone else God besides the true God Allah, then it is shirk. So these things many a time lead to shirk. So I do agree with the Malaysian council that they banned Muslims from doing yoga.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the brother?
Hallelujah. I can ask for some question with you before I thankful Dr. Tun Mathir, because very nice opening the program. And also my High Commission Pakistan is here. And also I very respected. I am from Pakistan, Christian. My name is Yusuf Masih. And I want to talk with you Hindi and own language. Can you?
English.
No, dono mein agar Hindi baat kare to better ho jayega.
Sir, I can understand Hindi, but all this audience majority will not. There are very few Pakistanis and Indians here. So if you can't speak English,
because
speak in English.
I have a lot of questions.
Ask one question which is the most important.
But I want to ask with our language, easy for me and easy for you.
Okay, you ask in Hindi and because I translate into English.
Just now, one sister asked you some questions.
You ask in Hindi, I will translate in English. Yes, brother.
Okay. मेरा पहला सवाल ये है कि मैं पाकिस्तान के स्कूलों में पढ़ता रहा हूँ और सलामियात दुनियात सब कुछ पढ़ा मैंने, ठीक है. वहाँ पर हमारे टीचर थे कारी करामत साहब, तो अभी फोत हो गए, खुदा उनको जन्नत नसीब करे. तो माँ किताबों में लिखा है कि नबी मोहम्मद सब नबियों के नूर हैं, ठीक है. दूसरी तरफ आपने काफ़ी प्रोग्राम आपने देखे हैं, मैंने आपके तो आपने हमेशा लफ्ज़ इस्तेमाल किया हसाई. हम हसाई नहीं हैं, ठीक है. बाइबल में आपने पढ़ा होगा, बाइबल में आपको लफ्ज़ असाई कभी नहीं मिलेगा, ठीक है. ये आपने नाम दिया है. दूसरा आप देखें जलाली, किस नबी की पैदाइश जो जलाली है.
भाई साहब, कोऑर्डिनेटर ने कहा कि सवाल दो या तीन सेंटेंसेस में करो, उससे ज़्यादा करेंगे तो स्पीच हो जाएगा. आपका सवाल क्या, आप सवाल कीजिए, मैं जवाब दूंगा. दो या तीन सेंटेंसेस में आप सवाल कीजिए.
और मैं भी आपकी तरह बढ़ना चाहता हूँ ना.
तो आप क्या कीजिए, हॉल हायर करो और पेपर में इश्तिहार दो कि मैं तकरीर करने वाला हूँ. जो आने के आएंगे
वही ना.
तो आज आपकी तकरीर सुनने के लिए लोग ने आए, तो ये सवाल जवाब का सेशन है. आप सवाल पीछे दो या तीन सेंटेंसेस में बस.
आप ये बता दें इन दोनों नबियों में जलाली पैदाइश दोनों में किसकी थी.
कौन से दो नबी में से.
नबी मोहम्मद और यसू अल मसीह में.
द ब्रदर आस्क्ड द क्वेश्चन, क्या बिटवीन मोहम्मद सल्लल्लाहु अलैहि वसल्लम एंड बिटवीन जीसस क्राइस्ट पीस बी अपॉन हिम, who was more? Jalali can be translated into Jalali ka aapko ye bolo, who's better?
No, glory keh le.
Glorious.
Jalali padesh keh sakte hain aap. Better nahi, aap dono mein ye bataye ki dono mein se sabki muqaddas, dono mein se muqaddas padesh kiski hai.
Whether asking a question that who was born better, muqaddas padesh means who was born more pure. He is a Christian. He is asking a question, trying to lead me. And this Christian missionaries normally do. What is asking? Who was born more pure? Indicating that Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was born naturally. He had a mother and father. Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, had a mother but no father. So normally Christian missionaries ask this question, which is beating around the bush, and then asking that Prophet Muhammad had a mother and father. Prophet Jesus had a mother but no father. So who's greater? Who's greater? The reply to this is given in the Quran in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse 59, which says, "Inna masala Isa inda Allahi ka masala Adam. Khalaqa min turab, summa qala lahu kun fayakun." The similitude of Jesus in the sight of Allah is the same as Adam, peace be upon him. He was created from dust and said, "Be," and it was. if he wants to say that Jesus Christ is superior, he is God because he was born without a father, then Adam, peace be upon him, is greater God. He had no mother and no father.
No. Adam ko khuda ne banaya tha.
Bhai sahab, apne sawal puche, mera jawab suno abhi. Main jawab khatam nahi hua. Aapko lecture dene ka to hall air ko ishtihar do. Ye lecture ka time nahi, ye sawal jawab ka time hai. Aap mera jawab suniye. If they say that Jesus is God because he had got no father, then Adam, peace be upon him, is greater God according to the Bible and the Quran. Because he had no mother, no father. So the reason is that Almighty God is the creator. He can create in different ways. Normal human being to born, you require mother and father. But Almighty God even can create without mother and father, that is Adam, peace be upon him. He can create with mother, without a father, that is Isa alayhi salam. With a man and without a female is Bibi Hawa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator. So just because Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, has no father, that does not make him God. If that is the case, then Adam, peace be upon him, is greater God, which Christians will never agree. So this is what Quran says. When you talk with the people, non-Muslim, ta'ala wila kalimatin sawa'im bainakna bainakum, come to common terms as between us and you. So this is how Christian missionaries, they try and catch fish. They try and catch fish. They try and trap the Muslims by quoting from the Quran. And the Muslims who don't know comparative religion, they get trapped. If you hear my lecture, deceit in Christian evangelism. Deceit in Christian evangelism. How do they deceit the people with false things? And the trap is a full lecture of mine. That will give you how the Christian missionary try and catch fish. What we believe, we should not deceive anyone. We believe in haq. As I said in my talk, وَقُلْ جَعَ الْحَقْ وَزَاقَ الْبَاطِلْ إِنَّ الْبَاطِلَ قَانَ زَوْكَ. When truth is held against falsehood, falsehood perishes. For falsehood is by its nature bound to perish. What Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, said, I want to tell you, brother, in the Gospel of John, chapter number 16, verse number 12 to 14, I have many things to say unto you, but he cannot bear them now. For he, when the Spirit of truth shall come, he shall guide you unto all truth. He shall not speak of himself. All that here shall he speak. So what we realize, your Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, spoke about the last and final messenger to come, and his name is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him.
Okay, do we have a question from the brother at the back, non-Muslim brother? Yes, please go ahead.
Good evening. My name is Lloyd Leslie. I'm from Tanzania. I'd like to thank you for this opportunity you've given me today. I have a simple question. I'd really like to know, where does Islam stand in giving people second opportunities? Because I believe, as all human beings, we all make mistakes, but we tend to judge each other differently. If I break a glass or if I stab someone, it's okay, but it's different when someone commits adultery or kills. So how do you actually weigh sins? I just want to know that. How do you justify these things in Islam?
Brothers asked a very good question, that what is the Islamic viewpoint on giving someone a second opportunity? If you read the Quran and the Hadith, Almighty God does not give you a second opportunity, He gives you hundreds of opportunities. Hundreds. Allah says that never despair the mercy of Allah. Never despair, never think that Allah will never forgive you. That's the reason every chapter of the glorious Quran, except for Surah Tawbah, chapter number 9, begins with the beautiful formula, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. In the name of Allah, most gracious, most merciful. You may have done maximum sins in the world, yet never think that Allah will not forgive you, as long as you repent. Now, in Islam, there are certain criteria for repentance. If you have done a sin, and if you repent, Allah will inshallah forgive you. To repent, there are some criteria. First, you agree what you're doing is wrong. Number two, stop it. Number three, that if you can reverse it, the act, you reverse it. Number four, never do it again. Agree it is wrong, stop it, reverse it if you can, never do it again. For example, if you have robbed, agree it is wrong. Point number two, stop robbing. Point number three, if you can return the thing you have robbed, return it. Point number four, don't do it again. If you have done adultery, for example, agree it is wrong, stop it, ask for forgiveness, you can't undo it. Ask for forgiveness, don't do it again.
What about capital punishment? How do you explain?
Brother, that's a very good question. How do you explain the capital punishment? If someone held an adultery, what is the capital punishment? In Islam, capital punishment is there if there are four witnesses. In Islam, if someone does adultery and if you have four witnesses, then the person who has done adultery is supposed to be put to death. For your information, let me tell you that in the life history of Prophet Muhammad and the Sahabas, there were only a couple of people who were put to death, those who themselves wanted to be put to death. They themselves told the Prophet, I have done adultery. Prophet said, go away. Again the lady came. The Prophet said, when the child is born, come to me. The Prophet kept on evading, but she insisted. Then when she insisted, then the Prophet said, okay, stone her to death. And when she died, one of the Muslims cursed her. So the Prophet said, the forgiveness that she has asked for, even if you distribute in the whole city of Medina, yet it will be more. That means she wanted to be punished so that she will go to Jannah. There is not a single case in the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam where a person was put to death because of four witnesses. There were few cases, all of them volunteered to be killed. That means even today, even in Saudi Arabia, I don't know of any case where a person is put to death because of adultery, because of four witnesses. Unless the person himself or herself comes and tells, I have done adultery, put me to death. That means don't do adultery in public. It's a big sin. It's a major sin. It's the 10th major sin in Islam. But if you do adultery, it's between you and Allah. You ask for forgiveness, don't do it again, Allah will forgive you. Again you do adultery, again ask for forgiveness, and you repent, Allah will forgive you. The capital punishment only comes in the case where you do it publicly and if there are four witnesses who give witness. That means don't spoil the society. If you are doing hidingly, it's a sin. Don't do it, but you are doing alone. So all the punishments have got certain clauses in Islam. And Allah says that even if you have done a sin as much as a mountain, ask for forgiveness, Allah will forgive you. So in Islam, Allah is the God who is most merciful, most gracious, most benevolent. Whatever sins you have, you ask for forgiveness, Allah will forgive you. You change your lifestyle, repent correctly, and inshallah you'll go to paradise. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the mic over here?
Thank you once again, Brother Dr. Zakir Naik, the organizers and everyone present here today. First of all, allow me to just clarify my sharing on the last question that I asked during the ITM. Just want to assure everyone that I come with good intentions, and I'm quite sad and disappointed that some
brother, as the rule was mentioned, two or three sentences. We don't want you to repeat what you did in Shalom. Two or three sentences, no need of greeting us. Direct come to your question, two or three sentences, we'll give the answer. There are many people waiting in the queue, brother. So okay. See to it that don't do what you did in Shalom. Ask a question in two or three sentences, forget the surrounding. It's my field, answering question our session. Okay. Two or three sentences, ask your question, inshallah, I'll answer fast. Yes, brother.
I just want to, this is not a question, I just want to share another viewpoint regards the Ahli Kitab.
Brother, this is a question answer time. If you have a question, pose the question, that will be appreciated.
I say this because, very interestingly, because Malaysia also follow the schools of Imam Shafi'i. And Imam Shafi'i actually goes for the more open interpretations of the Ahli Kitab, as opposed to some schools and jurists that only limit it to the Jews and Christians. Actually, it's based on the scrolls of Abraham, the Psalms of David, Quran verse chapter 87 verse 19. And I hear a commentary by Prophet Hashim Kamali in this book, Common Grounds Between Islam and Buddhism, which I will present it to you afterwards.
Brother, I told you last time, Imam Shafi wrote the book Al-Umm. Get me reference from that, I will believe. You are getting a book somebody else wrote. For me, when I quote you Quran directly and read from the Quran, if you read from a book somebody else has written, that doesn't carry weight for me. For me, if you want to quote Imam Shafi, he had Jadid and Qadim. I have read that book. Quote me from that book. Don't quote me from a book somebody else has written. It's not correct. It's not verified. You are doing the same thing what is in Shah Alam. If you want to quote Imam Shafi, quote from his book Al-Umm, not from the book you are holding. The book you are holding is not Al-Umm. You go to the library, get the book of Al-Umm, get the translation, quote from that, I'll believe in you.
Do we have a question from the brothers Mike at the back? Okay, go ahead.
Hi, I have a question. How Islam see if a person is without religion, but he is happy and satisfied to his life? In logically, we can believe that a happy person would not easy to getting a criminal.
The brother said that if a person is happy in life, he will not become criminal. Many criminals become happy. So I disagree with your philosophy. There is no philosophy that a person who is happy in life will not become criminal. A person becomes a criminal and yet happy. As far as the basic question is, what does Islam have to say about if a person who does not believe in religion? What is the definition of religion is important. Everyone has certain way of life. Religion by definition means a way of life. Everyone has certain way of life. He may not believe in God, that's different. But everyone has a certain way of life. And that way of life, if it matches with the Quran, it is correct. We have to follow the way of life as prescribed by our Creator, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Quran says in Surah Al-Imran, chapter 3, verse number 19, Inna dina inda lahi al-Islam, the only religion, the only way of life accepted in the sight of Allah is Islam. Islam means submitting your will to Almighty God and following the commandments in the Quran. This is the only way that you can acquire peace, by submitting your will to Almighty God. And Allah says in the Quran in Surah Imran chapter 3 verse 85, if you desire and practice any other religion besides Islam, it will never be accepted of you, and in the hereafter you'd be among the losers. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the mic in front?
My name is Chandran. Good evening, Dr. Tun Mahadev. How are you, sir? And Dr. Zakir, how are you, sir? I have deep respect for you. I've heard you in the YouTube many a times, and I know who you are, sir. Okay. You said about the ratio of conversion. Dr. Zakir said India was ruled by Muslims for 1,000 years. And India is still Hindu. America and Europe may become Muslim countries because of you. But 1,000 zakir naik. Naik means up in Malay, no? Or 1,000 years from now, Hinduism will not turun, but will naik. For now, India will be Hindu. For even for 1,000 more years, even if the world is broken, up tomorrow, a Hindu will pray Namah Shivaya. Thank you, sir.
The brother asked the question that I said America, many people accepting Islam, and if Muslims ruled India for 1,000 years, yet 80% are Hindus. Naik means up. That was trying to prove that Islam wasn't spread by the sword. That answer I give in context, that if Islam was spread by the sword, then the Muslims, when they ruled India for 1,000 years, they would have forced everyone to become a Muslim. They did not do that. Regarding Hindu, brother, Hindu is a geographical definition for a person living in India. By definition, I am a Hindu. Hindu is a geographical definition, and I will remain a Hindu. It is not a religious definition. According to Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, the word Hindu did not appear in any of the Indian literatures until the Arabs came to India. This word Hindu was given by the Arabs. Hindu means living in the land of India. Even today when I go to Gulf countries, Saudi Arabia, they call me Hindi. Hindi means Indian. So Hindu is not a religious definition. It's a misnomer. Therefore, Swami Vivekananda said that Hinduism is a misnomer. They should be called as Vedantist. So if you say Hindu, yes, India will be there, inshallah. And I'm proud to be an Indian. And the people living in India are called Hindu. It's a geographical definition. It is not a religious definition. Nowhere will you find in the Vedas or Upanishad the word Hindu. It all came after the Arabs gave this word. The right word should be Sanatar Dharma or should be Vedantist. So this word is a misnomer. So geographically I am a Hindu because I live in India and it will remain there. But as far as the religion, the fastest growing religion throughout the world, today is Islam, not only in the Western world, even in the Eastern world. Throughout the world today, the fastest growing religion in the world is Islam. And inshallah, inshallah, this religion will keep on spreading, as you said, Naik going on top. I know that. Someone told me that. And in Sanskrit, Naik means a Mujahid. It means a hero and means a Mujahid. Once you strive and I am a Mujahid. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the sister?
I have a question here from a non-Muslim sister, but she's not, she don't want to come in front.
Okay, we will accept here once.
A non-Muslim sister has accepted Islam. She believes in one God and prayers, but she cannot tell her family as it is will endanger her life. Her family wants her to marry a non-Muslim. If she marries a non-Muslim, does that make her a non-believer again?
The sister has said that she believes in Islam, she believes in one God, she has become a Muslim. But her family doesn't like it and family wants to force her to marry a non-Muslim. So does that make her an unbeliever? It's clearly mentioned in the Quran, Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 221, that do not marry an unbelieving woman. Do not marry an idolatress until she believes. A believing woman is far superior than an idolatress, even if she allows you. And the verse continues, do not marry an unbelieving man, an idolater, until he believes. A believing man is far superior than an idolater. So marrying a non-Muslim, according to verse of the Quran, a person who does shirk, is prohibited. It's not allowed in Islam. If she has accepted Islam and she believes that Islam is the right religion, she believes in one God and Prophet Muhammad's messenger, then she should marry a Muslim only. If she marries a non-Muslim, it's not allowed in Islam. Hope that answers the question.
Thank you. Can we have the next question from the brother?
Yes, thank you for the wonderful talk. My name is Chai. I just want to know, since media is the most powerful weapon nowadays, certain irresponsible parties have released media which causes certain parties to resort to much violence method in solving the problem. According to our Quran, what is the best approach for this kind of scenarios?
The brother asked the question, I think he's referring to the innocence of Muslims, correct?
Yes, correct.
The brother is saying that sometimes certain things, as media is the most powerful weapon, certain things come into the media which hurt the feelings of other people. So what is the best strategy that should be done? Brother is talking about a movie that was released a few weeks before, Innocence of Muslim, which has caused turmoil in the Muslim Ummah, a UN cry. And I have given a reply that how Muslims should behave. Normally what happens that whenever such issues come, it's common for the Western world to bring out things which are against Islam. We had the case of Salman Rushdie wrote Satanic Verses, Tasliman Rasin wrote Lajja. Then we have the Danish cartoon, now we have Innocence of Muslims. See, normally when such things come, almost all the Muslims jump into the agitation. Number one, what happens is that if Muslims are doing certain productive activity, for example, one person is doing some 100 points of activity, I'm doing 100 points, he's doing 100 points. When such things happen, everyone jumps into it and we stop our normal activity. Maybe from 100 goes to 0.5. And we all jump into these things. Muslims are emotional, that is good, mashallah. But what happens? The growth of activity stopped. What I suggest, there should be specialized organizations to deal with such issues. How today the aid of specialization, we have heart specialists, brain specialists, kidney specialists. We should have specialized Muslim organizations to deal with these issues so that the other Muslims can continue with their normal routine activity of spreading Islam and not stop the growth. For this, I suggested 6 strategies. Number one, what I suggest is there should be a battery of international lawyers. The best lawyers from different parts of the world, maybe the best lawyers from Malaysia, from Muslim Gulf countries, maybe from India, maybe Sri Lanka, from different parts of the world, maybe best lawyers from UK, from USA. Whenever such things happen, we should file a case in the International Court of Law. I don't believe we will get justice. I know the International Court of Law is far away from justice, especially where Muslims are concerned. But at least we will put our point through. Have the best of lawyers. The person who has done the act, he should be brought to task.